All right. Here we go. Let's spin the wheel of Dharma. As the Buddhists like to say. And we're off and running. The Holy Spirit gave me a day off. How about that? I needed one. Absolutely needed one. And I think all of you did too. Time to catch up, catch our breaths. I actually got pushed and pushed and pushed and pushed and pushed to play golf. And I actually played golf. And I didn't want to. I tell you, I really didn't want to. Got to one golf course. It was closed. I said, what? Ended up going somewhere else to the driving range. I said, what the heck? Let me just see if I can play here. Got out. And it was an amazing experience because I was able to tweak a whole lot of stuff. New equipment, getting used to it. You know, I changed the loft of the driver, the three wood, the two hybrid, trying different things. And the wheel of Dharma is kind of slowing down here, isn't it? So we give it another spin like that. Okay. And very sore, very tired today. But it's a good tired. And I slept for the first time in ages. Ages. I didn't have a sudden awakening at 3 in the morning. I actually slept through to like 6:30 or so. So that's great. I really needed that. I've been under, you know, tremendous stress, as probably all of you have as well. And so just the time to catch our breath, I got the next stage has been shown to me of what to do. So we're just here relaxing, spinning the wheel of Dharma here like that. Now this is a rim from a old bike, and I think it was like from 1980 or something. The bike, it's old, but the rim, the bearings, everything is great. It's in it, you know. It's just the rest of the bike's no good. It doesn't work, but I have this wheel I can use as a Dharma wheel. It's great. Spins beautifully. Things were built really nicely back then. It's amazing, amazing. Keep the wheel of Dharma spinning, meaning keep your practice going every day. Don't let it stop as it slows down. Give it another spin. So this is what these wheels are. You see in Tibetan Buddhist prayer wheels, Dharma wheels. They said keep it spinning. In other words, keep your prayers going. Don't stop. Except here, we keep our very advanced practices going that are really quite beyond prayer, quite beyond prayer. So I've had a chance to allow a lot to arise, and of course I'm in the wow like we're supposed to be, which is super helpful. And I was able to get a very nice overview. And so as we keep this wheel, Dharma wheel, spinning like this, the momentum of our prayers, the momentum of our practice, the momentum of our affirmations, the momentum of the wow, momentum of our breakthroughs, momentum of our clarity, you know, we just keep it going like this. Just you know, it doesn't take too much effort to keep this going, does it? It really doesn't. It really doesn't take that much effort. It's just to remember to do so. You have to remember to do so. And yet it slows down after a while. And give it another spin like that. Give it another spin. So this is what we do. This is what we do here. Now, what I was told I have to do is stay away from the quote-unquote wildlife. I actually was made so much progress one day. I was just shocked, so shocked by it. I actually started watching some music videos, looking for some stuff online, falling back into old habits. And it was I had a dream. And it showed me that my clothes were all dirty. I had this beautiful white clothes on, and this terrible black soot and stain everywhere. I said, oh my gosh, what happened? And I know what happened is that just a little bit of that is enough to really contaminate us. It's like psychological radioactivity, actually. And the truth is, it really is. It's like the world is full of this radioactive, poisonous radioactive substance, but it's psychologically radioactive. And it's the internet, it's the smartphones, it's the video games, it's television, it's the movies, it's artificial intelligence, all this. And so I experienced this in a dream showing me just how bad it had tainted me, just that one evening of a little of this and a little of that. But I knew, I said, well, I should stop this. This is going down a bad direction. It seems like it's almost impossible to do anything on the internet without contacting this radioactivity, getting severely contaminated by it. So I was thinking maybe I should just quit taping altogether. And the Holy Spirit said, no, just learn how to limit it. Just do the taping, upload it to YouTube, and then shut the computer down. Okay, shut it down and put it away. 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 So the don't give yourself... Don't allow yourself access to it. That's why I say the smartphone is so terrible, is you're constantly tempted. You have it at all times. And right now, the contamination of our culture, society, world is worse than a nuclear war, actually. Way worse. That can just harm your body. This stuff contaminates your psychology, your whole outlook. It doesn't harm the mind. The mind can never be harmed, but it certainly adds to massive delay for us in terms of recognizing we never fell asleep. We've never not been awake. We've been pretending to not be awake. It adds massive delay to that, and the delay is just completely useless. I mean, it just, you regret it because you look back and you realize, I didn't need to do any of that. That is so stupid. Why did I do that? So, it's extremely important. I mean, you can get radioactive, die from radioactivity. The body dies, but the habits of the mind don't get contaminated by that. But you can stay in this world and put your attention on the world the way it is now, and you will be severely contaminated with the attitudes and activities and habits of delay. And that may cost you many lives as you go along the wheel of transmigration, So, place an absolute premium on staying away from all these sources of contamination. I've been doing a great job, but I slipped a little bit. Just a little bit, but that was enough. I could feel it. I could feel I was really going down and in danger of losing the momentum. And at that point, I said, well, I can't do that. And so let's just turn everything off, put everything away, and we're done with it. So I'm certainly willing to do that. But because there are still viewers, it's holding fairly steady. I said, no, I'm not going to... just abandon that. That's not really me. Let's see if we can find something that actually works for everyone. So it's really not a big deal, to just keep this wheel, the Dharma wheel of practice, Dharma wheel going like this, is it? No, it isn't. And we might forget, but then you give it another push and get it going again. So if it happens to stop, as it may, then just get it going again. That's all. It's that simple. What's the key? To be dharmic, what's the key? And really, it's easy to boil it down to the very essence of it all. And it's the Holy Spirit. It's the grace of God. That's it. If you don't turn to the grace of God, if you don't believe in it, if you don't turn to it, if you don't accept its help, then you can't be dharmic. It's impossible. Now, you could say it's guru's grace, you can say different thing terms, but it's all amounts to the same. Okay. And then from that point, you add on some accessories, but really everything is just accessorizing the Holy Spirit, actually. So all praise to the Holy Spirit for doing just a fabulous job for us. And then all praise to some of the witnesses to the Holy Spirit, the Dharma kings, for doing everything they can to help us. They're doing a fabulous job, that's for sure. Keep the wheel of Dharma going like this. Not too much bother, is it? Now, if we get really distracted, yeah, it'll stop for a while. It might even get rusted. This was really rusted. I mean, it was. I just sprayed a lot of lubricant on this to get it going. The chain was completely locked, rusted, and locked. It still is. I can't loosen it up. But this front wheel has gotten really nice and smooth now. You see, so even if we've stopped our Dharma for quite some time, you know what? You can get it going again. We can all get it going again, actually. Now, we've probably been stopped since the 80s, when computers first came out. What was that? 81 or something? So this was like pre-computer here, I believe. This bike. Pre-computer. And if anyone has not yet sized up computers and artificial intelligence, then they must be, you know, incredibly foolish. We've had plenty of time to size them up, okay, and it's just, you know, it's so blatantly obvious that we want to limit our involvement with computers, artificial intelligence, as much as possible. It'd be nice to take a break from all artificial intelligence, take a break from driving. You know, so much driving I have to do. Just take a break from it and find out you can survive, and you'll feel better. You'll feel a lot better. So we probably all need to take some breaks, and that includes our smartphone. Okay, absolutely, all artificial intelligence. You know, for emergencies, you might still keep a little flip phone or something like that. I have a flip phone. That I could use for that, just in case. Yeah, but other than that, nothing, no electronics. Try to take just no electronics. Go play golf, for instance. I did pretty well, not having played for so long. Only played a couple times in the last year and a half, actually. And I got new equipment, new driver, new three-wood, new two hybrid, and used those for the first time, really, on the course, and hit mostly my three-wood. Now, we're going to talk about full stop in the wild as we keep the Dharma wheel going here. Very important, right? And there's a perfect illustration by what happened. What I say is, when we have great success, that is when we have to be the most careful and conservative and slow down, go into the wow, don't ask anything too much of yourself, and let yourself calm down, because the path that we're on is to recognize we never fell asleep. No one's ever fallen asleep, actually. It's all pretending. There really isn't any world at all. It's all pretending. There's no fixation of awareness at all. This is the non-dual path, the true non-dual path. What you see, you glimpse your freedom, and you say, oh my God, this is true. It's so easy. And this brings elation. Deep elation. Superficially, we might not think, it's like, oh, okay, but I don't see anything. You know, the sun, still sets in the west. And but what we're talking about is the subtle, at least to us it seems subtle, deep feeling is what we work on. Okay, superficial stuff we don't really pay attention to. We don't work on it. That's what secular, non-dharmic culture works on almost exclusively, is the superficial. Dharmic culture works, the practice is on the deep, subtle. Okay, we call it subtle. It's actually blatantly obvious, but superficially, we still can seem to function okay. But when there's upheaval and we see that great clarity with the depth to it, it does affect us, our superficial functioning, to some extent, to a little extent. And I was a bit off the last couple of days because of so much progress I've made. I'm missing turns, exits. I'm just kind of, an autopilot and making mistakes. And I forgive myself. I realize, hey, I'm really, really deeply affected by elation and seeing so clearly. And it really shocks. It shocks, has deep shock. So non-dharmic culture ignores this. It says it doesn't exist. It drugs it out. It tries to drug it so it doesn't experience any of that. But what we do is we pay great attention to this. And we don't pay much attention to the superficial at all, actually. It's just autopilot, the superficial. And when we feel a little down, we have low expectations of the superficial. Low expectations. So what happened was, I went on this golf course. I went to one golf course that was closed. They just went home and locked the pro shop. I said, what? So what do I do? I'm going to go home. And I said, no, let me go to the driving range. And then I decided, let me play here. So I started playing. And I don't know the course. And some three guys came up behind me and said, oh, we play every day here. And you want to join us? And I was thinking, maybe I can go ahead. And I don't want to join up. And I said, what? But I said, no, I don't know the course. These guys know it. They can help me with it. And I said, that's a smart decision. Ordinarily, I would have gone off by myself, but I said, let them help me out. So they helped me out. Really, very helpful. Very, really good guys. Having a blast out there. And but because I didn't know the course and where it goes or anything, what I decided, I'm going to play conservatively. Conservatively, and use a 3-wood off the tee. So I used a 3-wood, 3-metal, and I hit it well, really well. First time I ever used it. Hit it well. But I didn't really know where I was going. And, I hit some shots that I didn't realize exactly where I was supposed to hit them entirely. It's hard. It's a tricky, very tricky course to figure out where to hit it. But all in all, I was doing well. So I got to this next hole, and I said, it's working great. So I hit a 3-wood out there pretty well. I had 167 yards to a hole that I could hardly see. It sort of zigged to the right behind some trees. I said, well, I know it's up there somewhere. 167 yards. I've got the club for that. I'll hit a 5-hybrid. So I had a 5-hybrid, and I just absolutely smoked it on a line, just this gorgeous shot, but I couldn't really see what the results were. And I said, well, it's up there somewhere. I know that. So I went up to the green, and there's a ball close to the hole. I didn't know it might have been someone else's ball, so I didn't know. As I walked up, I realized, oh, that's my ball. Just a tremendous, tremendous, tremendous shot. A pro shot, and the guy said, "Hey, great shot! That's really something, man. From where you were, that's tremendous." And so I said, "Well, all right, let me just kind of relax here and put a nice roll on the ball." So I put a nice roll, kept my head down, didn't look too much, and the ball's trundling along. And it took a look in the left side and says, "You know what? Gravity tells me I want to go in." And so it curled in the hole for a birdie. And, wow. How about that? That's the way to finish it off. And so I went to the next hole, and I was pumped up. And I looked at the next hole, and I said, wow, this is a straightaway hole. Downwind. I said, miles, I feel the adrenaline. I feel strong. I'm elated. I feel like I'm a hero. I said, let's do this. And I pulled out the driver. And something in the back of my mind was saying, you're doing great with the 3-wood. What are you switching for? This is not smart. I got greedy. I felt the adrenaline rush. I felt like I can do this. So what did I do? Snap hooked it into a waste area off to the left. And we looked and looked and looked and looked and looked and couldn't find it. Lost ball. And I told the guy, I said, well, that's the price I pay for being stupid. That's the price I got to pay for being stupid. I said, man. So When you get an insight, when you have your clarity arises and suddenly the clouds part and you say, oh my gosh, I've never seen so clearly before. I've never seen this before. This is what the non-dual teachers have been talking about. And I'm seeing it. You feel elated. You feel like you're getting it. And of all the hard work you've done to suddenly get it like this, it just causes this deep inner feeling that's, you know, it's just hard to describe, but you're just humming. I mean, and so at that point you feel like, wow, I can, you know, I can start getting greedy, say, hey, let me really push things here, you know, I can get it all like that. Next thing you know, you've lost it all. You've lost it all. So today, looking back, I realized, boy, that was a big mistake. What do I do next time that happens? Next time I get a birdie, the next hole, play really conservative. Play really conservative. Just lay up in the fairway. We just use a two hybrid or something, or, you know, just make sure you get into the fairway. Just so you're off and running on the next hole, and you give yourself time to calm down. Maybe even take the entire hole conservatively the next one. Play conservatively. But the thing is, if you get greedy, you say, I got one birdie, maybe I can get two in a row. That's what I was thinking. I'm on a run. I'm ready to make a run here. Okay, big mistake. Big mistake. Instead, say, you know what? I just played that last hole like a pro, and that really shocked me. And I'm elated. So I know I can do it, but right now I'm too pumped up, and I might get out of my groove. So let me really stay very conservative, and let me just take a bogey on the next hole. Doesn't matter. Just don't lose my ball. Don't hit bad shots. Just stay smooth. Stay smooth. Stay smooth. And once I calm down at some point, then maybe I'll get another birdie. And so I said, you know what? I'm going to commit to that. I'm going to commit to this. It's a difficult thing to do. Really difficult. Everybody falls prey to this. Even the pros fall prey to it. Oh, are you kidding? When they make a really like an eagle or something, I notice, look out for the next drive. They often hook it, snap hook it or something. They're too pumped up. Or if they get into the lead of a tournament or something that makes them really pumped up, they then tend to run into terrible troubles. It's human nature, okay? You're seeing it. What happens? Happens to the very best of them. And the commentators are aware of it too. They say, better look out, you know, you might be too pumped up. Let's see how you can handle this adrenaline rush and all this stuff. It doesn't work out well. It doesn't work well very often. So we can really learn from that. And we know this practice, full stop in the wow, is when we make progress, which we certainly do as we're going forward, as we're committed, the Holy Spirit brings great progress to us. We have to be sure to then go very conservative. Go into this wow mode. And so I should have just, you know, just babied something out there. Made sure I didn't get into trouble. Hit the next shot, even short, doesn't matter. Chip up, two putt, go to the next hole. You know, don't get greedy for some birdie run. I'm not ready for that. Not ready for that. You know, that would, you know, be too much. That's what the pros do. They go on birdie runs. But, And we get greedy, but I know it could happen down the road if I stop getting greedy like this and keep myself focused and relaxed. Sure, it can happen. It can happen. But we have to practice in a very wise way here in this world. We have to be very, very wise. That's what the Dharma is all about, is being very wise. And understanding human psychology, understanding human nature, meaning understanding delusion and expectation, and how we undo delusion and expectation, how we let it go, how we reshape our expectations, and how difficult it can be, very difficult. So I'm looking forward to the next time I play, and when I do something really, really, really great, I'm going to slam the brakes on. So I'm got that in my mind. That's the one key. One of the keys I'm going to bring to the course. There are some others. And I'll talk about this. So I'm able to relate the Dharma to everything I'm doing. Okay, and I want everyone to do this. It's very important. Dharmic culture is not just sitting in a cave meditating. It's as you're doing everything else, you are still practicing. You're still applying the wow. You're still applying your attention. Okay, your play of attention is still spot on, and the Holy Spirit is guiding your play of attention. The Holy Spirit guides your play of attention. So you have to feel that you are on stage. I mean, you are on. You know, you're not taking a break from that at all. So you keep this wheel of Dharma spinning all the time, all the time. Now, there's this golf course that's been my bugaboo. It's a beautiful course, wonderful course, but ultimately I figured out it's unplayable. It's unplayable. And this course has tortured me for many years because I keep thinking there must be, you know, how come I, you know, what's wrong with me? What's wrong with me? And if you look at it carefully, you'd say, really, I've only seen one person play it well. Only one person. He was a collegiate star at, I think, New Mexico State or something. A really good golf team. I don't know if he was a star, but he was on the golf team. And it's a really good golf team. And, you know, this guy was just extraordinary golfer. Young, powerful, athletic. And he conquered that course, you know, because he putted like amazing. Everything he did, he had the right strategy for it, which is basically to hit your irons a mile, which is what he did. He teed off with an iron, like a 3-iron. Hit it like 250 yards or something, and then, or whatever, 240 in the middle of the fairway. And then wherever he was, his approach shots were just gorgeous approach shots right on the pin. I was just like, holy cow. He could, you know, hit like a pitching wedge, 150 or something. So it's like 3-iron, 250, pitching wedge, 150. That's 400 yards, you know. So he was able to put the ball close to the hole, and then he was able to make the putts, which I've never seen anybody do there either. And so he almost shot par. And of course, if he played the course a bunch of times, I'm sure he could shoot under par there. But that's the only player I've ever seen play that course properly. And he was an exceptionally talented. He had the type of game that can handle that course. But other than that, you basically, the only other way to play the course is to be able to hit your driver extremely well, extremely straight and long, extremely straight and long, and that's another way to play the course. But if you, any mishits in, and you're going to lose your ball, really. So the best strategy is the long irons or a hybrid, hit your hybrid really straight and long. Not too many people can do that. So this course crushes everyone. If you can't do that, one of those two, you can't play the course. You're just playing for bogey. Maybe you can get a few pars, and a lot of times double, triple bogeys. It's just, the reason why is the greens are so difficult. Multi-level greens, they're so fast and difficult. If you can't get your approach shot close, you're going to three-putt more often than not. So in order to get close, you have to be hitting a short iron. And in order to hit a short iron, you have to be long off the tee. The problem is that the bunkering is terrible, and the out of bounds is everywhere. So if you don't hit it really straight, you're going to go in a terrible bunker or out of bounds. So if you mishit your driver just a little bit, you're in dire trouble. You really have to hit it straight and long to have a short iron. So super diabolical course, so difficult. Now, so I figured, you know, I can't do it. And I just sort of said, Holy Spirit, you know, if there's a way, let me know. And then suddenly something came into my mind and said, why don't you go back to that shot? Remember years ago, as we keep the wheel of Dharma spinning here. So we're just chatting, and the important thing here is keeping the wheel of Dharma spinning no matter what we're doing, right? Why don't you hit that shot you used to hit? You practice it for a while. Remember that? You put the ball back in your stance, hit these real low bullets, just line drives, really, really tremendous line drives. I went straight. I said, yeah, I remember that. And I said, yeah, but I want to hit like this majestic, beautiful shots. And the Holy Spirit said, you know, remember I've been telling you to lay low, to lay really low. Part of that is not commenting on the internet, making comments other than here perhaps, but really not interacting, not becoming interactive. Lay really low, keep yourself low, keep very humble. It's super important, all important. Stay low, 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 low. The Holy Spirit says, well, why don't you hit those low shots? Why don't you hit a really low draw? A really low draw. I said, huh. I started thinking about it. I said, you know, now let me think if that would work. And I started going over each hole, and I said, well, it would work on number 1, it would work on number 3, It would work on number 4. It would work on number 5. 6 is a par 3. It would work on 7. Work on 8. It would work on 9. You hit a different type of shot. 10, you don't need it. 11, you would work on 11. It would work on 12. 13 is par 3. It would work on 14. It would work on 15. It would work on 15. 16 par 3. It would work on 17. It would work on 18. So it would work on virtually almost every par 4 or 5 on the golf course. That shot would work. I said, holy cow. If I could hit that really, really hit a, you know, blistering low stinger shot, they're called, which is really how Tiger Woods won so many majors, a lot of majors, was hitting that low stinger shot. He used an iron to hit it. But he could just put it out there in the fairway like 250 with almost without fail. And on tournaments like the U.S. Open and majors, that's how you win. If you have really good second shots and putting, chipping, etc., which he did, keeping it out of the rough, keeping it out of trouble. And he was able to do that. That low, boring shot with a little draw to it or a little cut. And so I said, you know what, let me try that. Let me just go home and practice swings. And see, I'm going to try it. I said, I'm going to try it. That would be, yeah, maybe I'm strong enough to do that. And so I did try it, and I figured out a swing. And I got the loft of my club back down to 8.5, very low loft. And I said, you know what, I'm going to give this a try. This might really, really change things. Keep it really low, really, really, really low. Because if you get it up in the air there with some spin, it starts drifting, and you give it too much time to drift, and that means it goes out of bounds. But if you keep it really low on a line, there's something about, as long as you start in the right direction, it's not likely to drift too far and go out of bounds. You have to make sure you get it started in the right direction, of course. So it's not like it's entirely easy by any means, but it takes a lot of trouble out of play. So this is in with the theme of staying low, staying low, staying low. Take the safe shot, the really safe shot. Stay really safe right now with you, and stay out of trouble. And of course, the internet has a massive amount of trouble on it. I mean, as soon as you start clicking, click this, and before you know it, it's amazing. Like on YouTube, I click a song, and then I see some other song. Oh, I'd like to listen to that. Click that. Oh, that, let me see another one. Click that. Before you know it, there's all this. You feel like you've been slimed by everything that pops up, and actually the song itself, and it just starts. You realize how non-dharmic it all is. It's extremely non-dharmic. Music is very dangerous. I really have to stay away from it. I stopped singing. Actually, I started last night. I started singing again. The night before, I started singing again. I said, "Oh, let me start to make some music videos." And before you know it, I was, you know, forgetting the Dharma. It was amazing. It was amazing how quick it happened. How the old habits suddenly sprang back to life. It's shocking, actually, how that happens. Scary, very scary to see that happen. How suddenly I was going back to my old ways. Really, 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 really severely back to my old ways and ready to do it. I said, I got to get the recorder out. I can sing to this song. What happened was, you see how this, I was actually editing a video. And I looked up some song. No, I saw this song pop up by Gold City, this gospel song. I said, wow, they're really good. I listened to it. It was really, really good. And then I said, I wonder if I can get that. Let me look up that song if anyone else does or something like that. And it came up, and there's this song. It said, backing tracks, some type of backing tracks. I said, crossroad backing tracks or something. And I looked, and it was like the music without the singing. And then I found out they do hundreds of these backing tracks for gospel songs. So I started singing along to these backing tracks, just making up my own lyrics. And it was fabulous. I was just having an absolute blast. I said, holy cow, I can record these songs. I really can. And I can be really good at this. I can be really, really good at this. So then I ended up clicking on this. The song, I said, oh, that's a nice song. I was on the side of YouTube, you know, this video. Oh, I said, I'm going to listen to that song. I listened to it. And then I heard this singer. I said, who is this singer? He's so good. He's really good. I know how it all happened. You know, one thing led to another. I said, oh, I'm singing along so great. Let me listen to some Dion. And see if I can sing along with that. I said, oh, and then I started to be able to do really, really well because I haven't been doing it for a long time. And sort of my ears have refreshed themselves. Everything's refreshed itself. I said, oh my gosh, it's easy. I'm singing better than I ever have in my life. And then I clicked on a song by Dion called Runaway. I said, let me listen to this version. And then suddenly I saw this other version. I said, let me listen to the original version. So I listened to the original version, and that's by Del Shannon. And then I said, let me listen to some other songs by Del Shannon. And then I realized that he's like an incredible singer. He was an incredible singer. I'd missed that. And I said, this guy is one of the best singers I've ever heard. He has an amazing voice. And so I started listening to some of his other songs. And before you know it, you know, I said, hey. And then I saw this one song of him performing like in a field, kind of. I said, oh, that's fun. I want to do that. You know, yeah. Of course, that was a few days before he suicided. And I got this feeling came over me by watching this. I said, oh my gosh. And it brought back all these memories of my life and with music and how terrible it was and how suicidal I felt. And I said, you know what? If I get back to music, I'm going down the path to suicide as well. No doubt about it. No doubt about it. I saw that very clearly. It brings that out, I'm telling you. It's scary, very scary. And, you know, a lot of musicians have suicided on substance abuse or one thing or the other, actually. It's an empty life, you know. You're making everybody else laugh and smile and stuff, but you feel very disconnected from the Dharma. It's horrible. But people love you. You think you're the greatest thing ever, you know. But inside, you're dying. You know, you think there's something horrible. I can't stop. Everybody wants me to keep singing, keep playing. And I almost, you know, I was just... By the grace of God, I stayed out of all that. Somehow, it didn't get me, but it got me real bad, but I'm still here because I got away from it. Okay, music can really be the devil. There's no question about it. I advise people to stay away from it. So I said, no, I'm not going to sing. I'm not going to do any of that stuff. I decided to forget it, you know. And then I said, let me get away from the computer. This is really causing me problems, bad problems. And you think, oh, a little bit won't hurt, but you know what? You go down the rabbit hole so fast, you can't believe how fast you go the wrong direction, especially with music, especially with something you're used to doing. You know, people start praising you. Non-dharmic people start praising you. Say, oh, that was great. I love when you do that. Of course, they don't mention the other stuff. And I say, well, that's okay, too, but this is just, you know, wonderful, that kind of thing. Before you know it, you're trying to please the world, right? You're trying to please the world, and you're not keeping that wheel of Dharma spinning. You let it stop. So that was really shocking. I was starting to look at baseball scores again. I was starting to look at sports scores. And I realized that's a terrible habit because that also ruined my life, paying too much attention to sports. I got so, you know, off the Dharma from doing that. And here I was starting to go back to music, back to sports, back to this. And all this stuff starts rising up in my mind. The whole syndrome of the flesh started rising up in my mind and trying to grab my attention. I said, no, we're not going to do that. No. So, we'll see how adamant I can be about putting a stop to all that. You see, as it slows down like this, it's like, holy cow, you got to give it another spin. So you have to really stay on it every day. Really stay on it. And it's not easy for anyone. I mean, I was very surprised that I was getting bit by it. But that's because the progress I made was so extreme that I was kind of like searching for refuge, saying like, wow, I'm kind of scared of the future. Let me go back to the past. I'm being too successful. You know, what is my life going to be like? Let me go back to something that I'm familiar with, that I know I can do well and have fun with and all this. I said, yeah, but it really wasn't fun, was it? It was horrible. It certainly was horrible. And it's interesting, this man had his transistor radio on with music the whole time he was playing golf. And I don't know how he was doing it, but maybe it was an MP3 player or something. And on the hole that I got that birdie, the tee off, there's Jimi Hendrix All on the Watchtower was playing. I hit a great tee shot, and I said, well, you know, hearing Hendrix, got me in the mood. He said, it's always nice to hear Hendrix. He said, yeah, it gets you in the mood, gets you flowing in the right mood, right? And I said, eh, yeah. And I thought, you know, excuse me while I kiss the sky, Jimi Hendrix. Hey, let's not forget what we're here for, actually. Spaciousness. Abidance. Right? Abidance, abidance, abidance. Not just, you know, kissing the sky, but staying in the sky of abidance. And of course, Hendrix basically suicided, you know? Right? With drugs, absolutely. They just can't take it anymore. You know, it's a nasty, nasty lifestyle. That is for sure. And people who want to avoid dharmic life, they say, I can substitute the music for it. Let me substitute the music, or let me have it both ways. But you know, they don't. You know, they let the wheel slow down too much. They really do. You have to really keep the wheel humming to get off the awful death wheel of transmigration, the dreadful death wheel of transmigration, to recognize the trick of attention that we're using, so that we realize we've never been on it. No one's ever been on it. In order to do that, you really have to keep the wheel of Dharma turning in your life. You keep it turning. I've tried to keep it turning swiftly every day, all day. Sri Sri Ananda, my boss, her goal for us was to practice 24 hours a day every day. I mean, give every day, the full day, keep the wheel of Dharma turning. And, you know, I've really been able to do that by and large now. Gradually becoming more and more focused on it, more and more focused on it. But I didn't start out that way. You know, it was sort of fits and starts, and a little bit here, a little bit there. But I did try to, you know, really make sure every day I did something, and so my attention was pretty good, but to actually increase the intensity of it, so the intensity is there, you know, most of the day, you know, that really takes a lot of getting used to. But she said that's what you should do. You know, that should be your goal, and you should reach that goal. And she said, when you reach that goal, the path goes very swiftly. Goes very swiftly, actually. And that's what I've been experiencing. Very swift indeed. And it's so shocking to us, because we have been conditioned, we expect to just keep suffering forever. And to see that this is not true, you know, if you've experienced this, you know the deep down, the deep elation, right? That it's just, how could there be anything greater than this? To recognize your expectations telling you really that you have to, you'll be suffering forever, actually. You'll never get free of it, actually. And to see this isn't true, and to see that you can get free, it just produces this excitement in you, deep excitement, elation, that is so super profound, that you really have to calm yourself through the wow and commit to a singularity that covers everything. Commit to a singularity that just covers all reactions, all thoughts, all feelings, all hopes, all fears, all definitions, all structures, all plans. It's just wow. And where does abidance come from? Commit to a singularity there too. It comes from wow. It comes from wow. Because we want a continuity of causation. So we want to think, well, how did this dream cause abidance? Well, we say, well, wow caused it. Okay, so this is a pragmatic tool we use, using the singularity. So if you're dharmic, you have experienced success in one way or the other. And you know those moments where you have these breakthroughs. It's like it's unforgettable. It's just unforgettable. You just realize, oh my gosh, this path, this what I'm doing really will work for me. It does work. There is light at the end of the tunnel. You know there's light at the end of the tunnel. And so imagine that if you're in this dark tunnel and you think you'll never get out of this tunnel and your beingness is circumscribed by this dark tunnel and you're thinking, well, I got to make the best I can do. Let me get a smartphone here in the tunnel and have some fun in the tunnel with a smartphone. Deep down, you're feeling like, gosh, you know, this is dreadful. I don't know how I can bear this. Take drugs to try to cut this anguish down, you know, and then to this move a little bit, yeah, and then to suddenly realize, just out of the blue, suddenly realize you see light at the end of the tunnel. I say, what is that? I say, oh my God, that's light. That is light at the end of the tunnel. And then you realize you're sitting there, and you say, oh my gosh, if I just start crawling through this tunnel towards that light, I'm going to reach that light eventually. And then you start trying to crawl, and like you're so atrophied and frozen up, you can't hardly move. And it's frightening to you. You say, no, I'm so used to just not going anywhere in this tunnel, just being stuck here. The idea of you're not so stuck anymore is quite shocking also. So what we want to do when we see light at the end of the tunnel is we want to, don't try to crawl, okay? Just say, wow. Don't try to crawl towards it yet. Have faith that you will crawl towards it. But right now it's not the time to do it, because you are really going to try and crawl too fast, and you'll get uncoordinated, and you're all frozen up, and so you'll bang around and fall and stuff, and you'll say, oh my gosh, that's too chaotic, I can't do it. That's too frightening for me. So mentally, you'll feel very uncoordinated mentally when you see the light at the end of the tunnel. And so instead of immediately trying to race towards it, just say, oh, okay, light at the end of the tunnel. What's my practice, my wisdom? Oh, wow. Full stop in the wow. I'm not going anywhere at this moment. It's like you get a birdie on a golf course. Next hole, hey, you know what? I'm not going to even try for a birdie. I'm going to get a bogey on this hole. I'm not going to try, and I'm going to go slow on this one, okay, because I'm really elated right now. And it's going to throw me off my game. So when we see light at the end of the tunnel, just say, okay, I'm not moving. I am not moving, because my heart is pounding. The elation I feel, it's so extraordinary. It just changed. My heart, entire future has just changed. My whole outlook has just changed. Everything is flipped. The script is flipped. And where there was destitution, there's now hope. Genuine hope. There's now this feeling of certainty, whether it's doubt and destitution. Now let this permeate you, and don't try to do anything at all. Be committed to doing nothing at all. And then gradually you'll get used to this newfound optimism, right? And then eventually you'll feel, you know what? I'm going to see if I can move a little bit. So you start unfreezing yourself, getting the rust off, and you do a little rust, you know, you move a little bit here, shout, you say, oh, this is tough, I'm having trouble moving, and then you say, that's okay, I'll start, you know, limbering up a little bit here, and so you start shuffling a little bit towards the light. You say, well, at least I can move a little bit, okay, that's good, and then you say, let me see if I can move a little bit more, and then what happens is you start to limber up a little bit and get unfrozen, and then you start to move a little quicker, you start crawling like a little quicker towards the light. And at that point, you realize, oh my gosh, I'm actually making progress, that I can tell I'm making progress towards that light. I thought I'd be frozen, but I'm able to actually make a little progress. And then another wow hits you. And you say, oh my gosh, I'm really getting there. And that's another extreme elation, you see. And so then you stop at that point, just stop for a while. Just stop. Calm down. That's still turning the wheel of Dharma because you're being very wise and being super dharmic. Then after you've calmed down and let this sink in that you're actually making progress towards that light, then you start again making some progress, and you find that after a while you're able to actually find a way to go even faster. Even faster. And then when you go even faster, significantly faster, that suddenly hits you, says, oh my gosh, that I can tell that that light is not as far away as it used to be. It's getting closer. I'm getting closer to that. The distance is not as far as I expected. I thought it might take me a long, long time, but now I'm seeing it's not going to take me nearly as long as I thought. Oh my gosh. And then that hits you. And then that really, really floors you. I mean, and just stop then. Stop in the wow. So you see how this works? So this works all the way through, all the way through. You get closer and closer, you know, at some point, like for me right now, I'm saying, my gosh, I can see I'm right on the edge of it, and there's no barrier at all. And I said, oh my gosh, I'm like at the end of the quote-unquote path, or I'm seeing, you know, the pathless path. I'm right, you know, towards finishing off, so to speak. And that's a huge shock, a huge shock. You see, huge shock. So every step of the way, you go through these, you progress, and then your progress shocks you because it really changes your expectations so severely. You know, I thought I was going to be, another failed life. Maybe I can make a little progress, but now you're saying, wait a minute, I might be able to finish this lifetime. Well then, you know, wow, that really changes my whole outlook about everything, doesn't it? and it's, again, your goal can be to make it this lifetime. And if you make it this lifetime, you're doing absolutely tremendous, absolutely tremendous. Not many make it in a lifetime, especially when they're young. Because then you have the rest of your life here to what? To witness to this. It's very profound. It's very profound. If you wait, like my case, to 60, you say, well, you know, maybe I have, what, 35 more years or something I can witness to it or something, but not like 65 years or something. That's like, I don't think I'm quite ready for that. So you kind of delay, you don't go too fast. But it's extraordinary if anybody, you know, can make it at all. And then if you make it with a lot of your life left, that's really rare. Very tough. So you should not feel bad at all if you think, well, you know, I'm going to make it this lifetime, and don't worry about when. Just I'm going to go for it, and I'm determined to make it this lifetime. And if you make it, you know, when you're old, that's fine. Many do that as well. Many do that as well. Some don't want to witness here in the world at all, and they make it maybe just before they pass away, they finally realize, but they don't really want to stay here. It's more difficult, it seems more difficult if you stay here, to stay in abidance here with the world, you know, that's what I've been working on, really. How do you, you know, it's so, that part, you know, I have so much love and praise for those who've been able to witness here, you know, for many years. It's just really extraordinary how they've been able to do that. It's very tricky. They really have to be in abidance to such a beautiful extent that they're not even tempted out of it at all, because the temptations here is just, anyway, it's sort of like a different game. That's big leagues if they're really going to witness to it quite a bit. So, you know, just say, I want to get to that light. I want to get to that light this lifetime. I want to get right there. And get close to it. Get to the edge of it, at least. And then, you know, to see how you feel then. But really see how you feel as you go along. But try to be determined. Say, you know what, I'm not going to do that scam of undoing. Because I know that's a scam, undoing. That's just proving that I fixated, you know, undo the body, undo some what you believe is a fixation, just to prove that it was fixated in the first place. That's the entire scam we're trying to play on reality. So you say, no, I'm not going to use that. I got to got to get to the light before I decide to undo the body, quote unquote, unfixated. It's nothing's ever really fixated at all, but we dream it is. So, and then you'll stay along the road of transmigration, go to some other realm, and like that. So keep the wheel of Dharma turning your entire life every day like this, and really say, my goal is really, really to accept truth as it is, you know, instead of trying to accept some imagined modification of it. Accept it as it is. So keep that wheel of Dharma turning like this. And you need to be determined. I'm very determined. I don't want to keep going along this, imagining I'm going along this wheel of transmigration. So we turn the wheel of Dharma to prevent that. Longchenpa has promised me, says, you will not continue. I will see to it. And I trust him in that. I believe that this is accurate. He will see to it. I'm far enough along so that I can understand how it's possible that you can get help in this. And if, you know, by applying my attention and determination, certainly I'll get off the, I will not be tempted to believe I'm on the wheel of transmigration anymore. I will not be tempted. I'll be able to overcome those temptations. I truly, truly believe that. So when he said that, I say, yeah, for sure. Thank you. That's wonderful. You realize you've never been on it. No one's ever been on it or in it. We're only a play of attention, imagining so. A very clever play of attention. But no one's actually on the wheel of transmigration at all, or in the transmigrating at all. It's a play of attention that's moving. but really, we're not fixated at all. We're still pure awareness, free awareness, actually. Just holding our awareness in certain patterns or habits that make it look like, you know, there's a fixation taking, compulsive fixation taking place. Yeah. So I practice swinging today at the club so much. Wow. And really, really, really figured some stuff out that I just... And got back to... Didn't have enough wrist at the top. I had been not really letting the wrists hinge loosely like that and relaxed at the top. I was tightening them up and not really doing... It's kind of going like halfway, like this instead of like that. And that makes a huge difference. So finally now, full wrist like this, and then late release and just whipping it through. And man, did I have speed. And I realized, wow, that's swinging fast right there. And I hadn't done that in a long time since I was young, that type of proper wrist action like that. Because I've been trying to steer it too much. And you think if you do that extra snap, you know, you feel like maybe... Something hit it too far, or I don't know what will happen. It seems a little loose, your shots. So somehow I, you know, was too stiff with that motion. I didn't really hinge it and stay loose with the fingers and the wrists and the arms. You got to stay loose like a whip, and that's where you really get the speed, the pro speed. And I hadn't been doing that, and I just realized that today. I said, "Holy cow!" So hopefully I feel okay in the morning. Another important thing I realized is I put down this sort of slick board that I stand on. So when I swing really hard, my feet kind of slide forward. And that saves my back and my knees. Problem with some of these golfers, like for instance Tiger Woods, there was a picture of him today, and I looked on the internet, this picture. Because I did research, you know, how to avoid back injury. And I believe that having this practicing when you're standing on something that's kind of slippery, so your feet can sort of slide with the momentum helps you avoid back injury. So I wanted to confirm that Tiger Woods had a really stiff front leg, and he had steel spikes, and he used this real straight stiff front leg to make his hips turn faster and give him extra power. Well, of course, it showed that he had like how many, many, many surgeries on that left knee and left leg. And then I believe that that's what ultimately put too much stress on his lower back too. The steel spikes, the stiff front leg, and the torque that he did. So when I swing really hard, put a lot of torque, but my feet swivel, you see, on this board, the slick board, they swivel a little bit with the power of the swing, whereas he would not swivel at all, be against a stiff front left leg stuck in the ground with long steel spikes to give that extra snap of power at the end. That overtorques your back and all the back surgeries. I mean, the injuries he has had, if you see this picture, all the injuries is just extraordinary. Two Achilles of both legs, you know, tendons, both knee surgeries on both, you know, neck, back, shoulder, it goes on, and elbow, arm. Holy cow. Too injured, too much injury. And so I said, how can we avoid that? It's interesting, the Holy Spirit had me get this slick board. He said, you got to do this, you got to be able to glide. And I finally did it, and now I see, you know, why? Because I'm swinging so hard now that if I don't sort of pivot with that momentum, it's going to be too much strain on my back. But my back feels pretty good, actually. You have to be careful, very careful your back when you swing that hard. And so you have to have a really strong core and to pivot like this. So now on the golf course, I just have plastic spikes, and they're not real, dig in really bad, and I should try it, see if it, how much I pivot, but I want to make sure that I try and pivot a little bit, don't dig in too much, and let the whole body kind of move instead of being on a fixed front side. Don't hurt the back, it's very important. The power I'm swinging with now could definitely hurt the back. Let's see if my back stays okay. So there are some things you can do, even when you're really powering it, with spiritual practice, like full stop and the wow, is like the pivoting on that board that I have, pivoting on it and sliding a little bit, so you don't hurt yourself. You allow yourself to ease past this great breakthroughs that you have. This powerful breakthroughs enables you to ease past it. You don't hurt your psyche too much. You say, no, I know where this came from. It came from wow. I know what the structure is. I know the causation. It's wow. I know the concatenation. It's wow. I know the whole story behind it, this breakthrough. It's wow. Okay, so I'm very well informed. I got all the definitions, the whole story, the causation. You know, why? How did it develop? Did it develop through wow? What's it going to help with? It's going to help with wow. How successful is it going to be? Well, it's going to be wow. What's the future hold? If it holds wow. And so you have all these answers for already there. And so it really eases your psyche when it's greatly disturbed by the success. And there's nothing more disturbing than success, because here we're so used to deep, deep expectations of despair and tragedy and hopelessness and such, that when all that stuff happens, we just kind of shrug our shoulders. I was really amazed how, when my cousin died in a rollover accident, how everybody just took it like in stride, like even her children, everybody. And like, I was the one that was most broken up about it, really. And I hardly knew her at all. But, you know, I just said, you know, it didn't have to be like this, you know. It did not have to, this is a tragedy. I don't accept tragedy. I really don't. So people were kind of amazed that, you know, I was really tearful and shaken up. And there's a few others that did. I helped them too. They feel it, like, you know, this is a tragedy. But some of her children just breeze through it like, it's another day. You know, nothing happened. Nothing. It's like nothing. You know, they may have been in shock, but actually her sisters felt it, you know, more than her children did. But they're more old school. They're more old school. And so tragedy, I don't ever get used to tragedy. Don't ever get used to stuff going bad or going wrong or anything like that. That's why I stay away from the news. I mean, anything goes bad, I feel it deeply. I say something severely wrong here. Anything at all. When I was young, I used to be that way very, very severely. If I saw any dead thing at all, it just struck me like a bomb. You know, I said, something here is not right. This is not right. And so I said, wow, I should not be seeing this. This is incorrect. You know, what's going on? Something's haywire. This is terrible. So, I mean, the news is just is crazy. I mean, the internet right now, they have a system, the way they do it. I recognize, of course, what they're up to, and it's really wicked, very, very wicked, the internet. And you can hardly click on any page, you know, without stuff popping up that is so terrible. It is on purpose, and it grabs your. It's hard not to grab your attention. It's best to just stay away. Just absolutely stay away from it. Just go to this YouTube channel. And, you know, and try to stay away from just about everything else unless it's really, really has no contamination. You know, you can somehow block it out. And I know YouTube is difficult because they pop up other videos and advertisements, et cetera. I just block them like this. I block if something comes up. I block it like that. I just use my arm, okay, just to block it. So my vision is blocked of it. But even then, it's tough because pages jumping around up and down, banners come up and stuff. To try to keep you, you know, seduced by what's going on in the world. But anyway, tragedy, you don't want it any at all, actually. And we shouldn't have to feel that, but we're so used to it that most people just take it in stride and they fill their whole lives with this junk, horrible stuff. It's just, for me, it's unimaginable how horrible it is. It's just so shocking to me, so shocking. Yet most people are so dull to it, they just wallow in it like pigs. It's unbelievable. You know, you couldn't pay me $1 million to watch a movie these days. It's just so terrible. Okay, it's so terrible. Dharmically, it hurts you so badly, actually. It hurts your momentum so badly. It's not, no money is worth that. And really, it's our own cleverness that's being employed here. So that's why I say stay away. Most of us don't realize just how clever it is. But when you start really getting clear about it all, you start recognizing how clever the mind has been. And then you realize, wow, don't mess with it. It's extremely clever. That's why the Holy Spirit told me, stop watching television long ago. And I said, no, I can handle it. The Holy Spirit says, you don't realize how clever it is. You just don't yet. Stay away. And I said, okay, I'll trust you on that one. Great, great decision. Because we indeed are very, 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 very clever and sly in trying to keep ourselves. This whole scheme we're running of trying to unfixate to prove that fixation happened is very, very clever, and how we keep ourselves still believing, you know, in death and all of that. We just keep thinking it's just normal. It happens just constantly, you know, tragedies everywhere, tragedies this. You know, oh, it's an accident. No such thing as accidents. No such thing as tragedy. That's all intentional. It's all intentional. It's all pre-planned, as Jesus said. It's all planned out in order to keep this deceiving ourselves. In order to keep deceiving ourselves. And you can easily get pulled into those patterns of self-deception around those who are doing it, and everyone in the world's doing it, really. To more or less, you know, more or less, that is for sure. So we keep the wheel of Dharma spinning here. So tragedy, we're so used to the horror, the death, the sickness, the lives, broken lives, tragedy happening in lives. You know, it's just the news just keeps pumping this awfulness. And back when I was playing golf yesterday, again, the man had this radio on, and the announcer, the DJ, cut in and said, and he went on this rant about God. So much so that one of his friends said, "Hey, are you not listening to a religious station, are you?" And he said, No. This guy just is going on a rant about God. Something bad must have happened in the world because he's saying, why does this have to happen? How come this is still happening? You know, why does God let this happen? Is there a God? If there's a God, why isn't God stopping this? I can't understand. And he was just so upset and angry. Of course, God isn't doing any of this. Not at all. We are spiritists. Intentionally to try and deceive God, actually. And so, and then the man, the golfer said, you know, something really bad must have happened in the world. And I was going to say something. I said, what day is it not happening? There's always something terrible happening that the news is churning every single moment. You know, really, right? But I didn't say anything, which was wise. I didn't say anything. I bit my lip on that one. Because then I'd go into a rant. So this world is a very toxic place, the way that it's playing out from our perspective. A frame of reference shift ultimately cures that. But until we have that frame of reference shift, we need to be very, very careful indeed about our attention. Again, the Dharma kings say, pay great attention to your attention and hang out with saints, the holy people, sages, and great books and great teachings and great prayer and great surroundings. Sri Sri Nanda, my ma, said that all the time. She says, boy, do not hang out around non-dharmic people and situations, etc. They will most certainly cut your momentum down, drag you down. Try as much as possible to stay in holy situations, she said. It's very, very important. Now, when our frame of reference shifts, it's a different story, because we don't even see any of that, actually. It changes so much. The frame of reference is such that we don't interpret it that way. We don't misperceive. But that's, you know, to get there, we have to really pay very close attention to our attention. And keep good company. And if you can't find good company, keep your own company and keep the company of the Dharma kings. Their teachings, their sayings, their pictures, whatever books are available, you know, keep paying attention to that all the time. And do not try to do it both ways, because you will find that is very, very troublesome. Keep the wheel of Dharma turning, as we were able to do here. It's a nice little practice, isn't it? It brings our attention to mind, like, hey, it does slow down here in this world. This world tendency is, our momentum tends to slow down here. Just the sheer inertia of disbelief here and the expectations of this of that's being reflected as a world, which is really just a reflection of our inner consciousness, the play of attention really is reflected as a world, and it is such that we so much are still stuck in delusion that it brings us down. It's, our momentum tends to slow down. The collective delusion is very strong in this world, no question about it. So we're spinning this wheel counterclockwise, countering the habitual expectations of this world, that we continue on compulsively with this compulsive effort to unfixate, in order to prove that fixation happened in the first place. So unfixation means death, decay, everything dying, everything decaying, that's everything becoming unfixated. We continue on with that in many ways, many realms, some more subtle than this, that we think is subtle, but more gross than this, and We can wander through so much. The wheel is vast. The wheel of transmigration is vast. But wherever you go, you will feel unsteady dissatisfaction, insecurity. You never feel like you've proved your point. You never feel like you've proved what you're trying to prove. And so you still feel very vulnerable. This wheel is still very true. I'm looking at it. It's turning. It's still very much a perfect round. You know, it's amazing. The condition this bike was in was terrible. Someone told me, you should fix it up. You should get it, you know. I said, what? It's not rideable. I don't really want to ride it. You have to put a new chain on it, new tires, stuff, and I don't know. I might do it at some point. I don't have the money for it. New tires, I don't think. I don't know how much they cost. I think bikes are so expensive now, I'm afraid to bring one down there. They end up, you know, can't pay for it. I don't know how to put a new chain on. But I could, you know, I could look into it, maybe. If I put a new chain on, it would, and two new tires, it would work. But I don't know how to put a tire on a rear cluster. That is, I see you do it from one side. Okay, yeah, but I'd have to have a bike person do that. I don't know if I could put a tire on myself. Maybe I could, but it's lacking the rubber beading too. That's gone. So I don't know. I'm not a bike guy. People are into bikes. They're so into bikes. It's unbelievable. Here, it's a mania here. Mania. Riding bikes. People spend so much money. My friend spent, what, $12,000 on a mountain bike, and he said, that's not even the most expensive. My friend rides one that's $15,000. I said, you can buy a new car for that. He said, yeah. And they just tweak everything. You know, they're just gearheads. It's unbelievable. Me, I could care less about it. I just use this as a Dharma wheel. Better use of it, right, than riding it? Use it as a Dharma wheel? That's a way better use. Yeah. And the ones who are stuck in duality say, why don't you do both? Why don't you do both? You know? Okay, this is touching this. Hold on. Let me move this out. Yeah. See, that's why you get caught. That's the trap, isn't it? How can you both... Both what? Either we're undoing fixation or we're not. Either there's fixation to undo or there's not. You can't have it both ways. Either our attention is fixated or it's not. To say to do it both ways is a delaying tactic. And they're saying, let me pretend like I'm interested in the Dharma and do it a little perfunctory while I frantically work at trying to unfixate so I can be greater than God. So we're kind of taking it easy here in this video, actually, right? Because we're illustrating something very important, which is the overall Dharma of keep it going, be back off when the wow arises, of success. Success shocks us so severely, way more than any tragedy. It shocks us deeply, very deeply shocks. Oh my gosh, there's abidance. So I have to practice calming down. What caused it? Wow caused it. Okay, wow caused the abidance. So that's all I need to know. Did wow cause it? No, but wow helped me accept it. Okay, so it's sort of a pseudo cause, you might say. Pseudo cause. But it's a tool, it's a pragmatic tool, like a bridge to help us calm down from it. So we preempt the question, what caused it? Because this is what pulls you out of abidance. If you've been in abidance, and you've gotten pulled out of it, which most do. If you glimpse it, wow, that moth went right through the spokes. How the heck did it do that? That was pretty cool. Don't fly in there, moth. But somehow it went right through it. I don't know. To the moth, there's no problem, I guess. So when we're in abidance, immediately the question arises, the habit, what caused it? So we believe in causation so much. In other words, how did you unfixate? What they're really saying, you found the way to unfixate. Congratulations. That's what your habits, your expectations are like that. That's called the ego, but it's really just our expectations. Say, oh my God, you're in abidance. It's great. And then the next little while you say, okay, now let you know how you did it. Meaning, how did you unfixate to get in this unfixated condition now? How did you unfixate what was fixated to do this? This is marvelous. You're saying like, this is marvelous. This is great. I finally reached my goal, but how do you help others? I mean, you got to explain to them, how did you unfixate? Because they can't figure it out. And so then immediately your mind starts thinking, okay, well, how did I do it? What caused this? And then, of course, very quickly, you're no longer in abidance. You don't no longer feel like your attention is no longer there where it was before. It's now your attention is on, well, what was the precursor? What was the concatenation? What steps on the path did I take? And so this will, could bedevil you your entire life. You could be bedeviled by this if you don't get help from the Holy Spirit and the grace of God and the Dharma kings. And the Holy Spirit said to say that wow caused it. Say before you even go into abidance, say, I know exactly what's going to cause abidance. I know exactly what the precursor was. I know exactly how to explain it to everyone. It's wow. Pretty smooth wheel, isn't it? Very smooth. So we're smoothing things out. The Dharma smooths everything out for us. So you're not going to go into abidance saying, okay, now wait a minute. How is this caused? Or think, oh my gosh, I hope the ego doesn't ask me how this was caused because that's going to pull me out. And that itself, you start worrying so much that takes you out. You start anticipating, well, what is the ego going to ask me? Let me preemptively wonder, check on what, think about what's the ego going to ask me? And how am I going to answer this? What if it asks me this? What if it asks me that? And that pulls you out of it. So here we say, all of that's already answered. I know the answer already. It's wow. And so practice that. The answer is wow. Wow causes abidance. Wow is how I got there. What did I unfixate? I unfixated wow. I unfixated wow. Wow is the culmination of everything. All dreaming, all imagining, all whatever fixation, if we want to say that, we can say that just for pragmatic purposes. And so I unfixated wow. It's wow is the answer. That's it. That's all there is to it. There isn't anything other than that. It's all right there. And so you don't, your mind doesn't start wandering. Now, it's a technique, which is fine. We have absolutely right to use techniques. The Holy Spirit wants us to. But you use the technique. It's like a crutch. You lean on the crutch. You use it. It's like a wheelchair. Use the wheelchair. Because you're temporarily floored. It knocks you, the legs out from underneath you, abidance. You say, oh my gosh, this is the Holy Grail, and I have it. Well, sit down in a wheelchair then and roll around in the wheelchair for a while. This could be like a wheelchair too, right? And just say, wow, wow did it for me. Wow did it for me. Wow explained it to me. Wow is what I unfixated. Wow is what caused it. I know the answer to all those questions. I already know the answer to the questions perfectly. Perfect answer to those questions. Now, the idea of practicing this is your expectations then get used to that wow is the answer. And so they don't even need to ask the question. So they say, well, I know how you got there. You did got there through wow. And you say, yeah, that's right. That's the expectations. So yeah, okay. So they won't pester you with all these, you won't get pestered with all these questions. You'll say, no, I know the answer. I don't have to ask the questions. So you precondition yourself to the answer being wow. And then this paves the way, smooths the way for abidance. So don't aim for result, the result of abidance directly like that. Aim to practice what thwarts you, which is these questions that arise. Great, great. Congratulations. Eureka, you did it. Now you get to tell everybody else how you did it and explain it to them and deal. This is wonderful. So what are you going to say to everybody and spread this throughout the world? It's marvelous. I mean, they're going to ask you, you know, these questions like this and this and this. And you just say, well, you know, what am I going to do? Wow is what I'm going to do. What brought it about? Wow brought it about. And so I have all these answers. And as far as helping other people, well, wow is what I will do concerning that. And get used to doing this. Now, if you really hold on to this, you will be quite shocked by it. You know, just like, holy cow. And so you need to wow the wow practice, actually. Because this is really something that you've probably never considered before. Like, I can actually do this? I thought that I'm not supposed to do this. Well, of course the ego tells us not to do this. Everyone says, don't do this. And so you start doing it, you say, oh my gosh, I didn't even know I could do this. This is amazing. I can feel, this is really, this could really work. This could really, really work because I never thought about doing this before. And this could be the very reason why I've been failing, certainly, is these questions arise. And this certainly conditions myself to feel like I already have the answers. So I don't even need to ask the questions in the first place. And so this just reason will tell you, well, this is very helpful. So keep the wheel of Dharma spinning as we look at this. I hit my 2 hybrid for the first time on the 10th hole, and it didn't go well. It went right. I had a problem. The next one went right too, and I said, "Wow, what's going wrong? Maybe I'm teeing it too low, or the loft was too low." And so, what I did was I actually changed the loft on it. Since I'm just practicing, I allow myself that. It's no problem. Not even worried about keeping score, and because you're experimenting out there, I changed it to like at least a degree higher, I believe. And I teed it up a little higher, and then I started hitting it beautifully, and I said, okay, this works. And on the fairway, I had a little trouble at first, but then I realized I need to stack my left side a little low, so I dig down a little bit more, so I'm not hitting it too flat. Give it some loft, get up in the air, and eventually I was hitting it, you know, pretty good distance, like 200 yards plus off the fairway. So that's what I'm looking for, like a couple hundred yards, 200 to 210 or something like that. Right now, with this additional wrist, maybe it'll go 210, 220, possibly. And I hit the 3-wood. I think I hit it like 237 off the fairway. Really, really hit it, crushed it, went a long ways. So the yardage is there, but I actually tweaked that. Up to 13.5. Yeah, I raised that up too. And keeping the wheel of Dharma going here. So even though we're not talking directly about this super intense stuff, well, you get burned out if you do it constantly. It'll burn you out. So you can't do it constantly. It's very difficult. Don't expect that of yourself. You can talk about other stuff, but keep relating it back. Keep relating it back. So I was swinging with this new loosed wrist, really whipping it through. And this increased my speed so much that my 3-wood, even though it has a stiff shaft, was bending. Three metal was bending a lot, flexing a lot more, because that's how I can tell that I got additional speed with that loose arms, loose wrists, really whipping it through so fast. It was bending. So I said, you know what? That's too bendy. It's too bendy. That causes shots to go too high, causes them to sail right sometimes too much. It gets it offline. So I said, wow, could I find a shaft that's extra stiff for this one to match the driver? I'm swinging so hard now, I need that. And I was able to go online and actually find one. Cheap, very cheap. It's amazing. Amazing. So, first time in my life, I'm going to be able to switch shafts out. I've never done that before. So there's a little improvement right there. So there's a tweak right there that I realized that this is going to help my game. I can really go at it then now. Really go at it. And the thing about extra stiff shafts, which is almost everyone on tour uses extra stiff shafts, is that you have no fear in your mind about really going after it hard. It's not going to, the shaft will probably not overflex. It can handle it. And it'll keep your shots a lot straighter, a lot more accurate. So now I feel I'm going to be able to just absolutely, you know, wail on it that is to the max and not worry about it, which is a good feeling. So as we are working on this non-dual acceptance here, it's a good feeling to, like, say, I have this wow. I'm really good at this wow stopping, full stop in the wow. So I can just go as deep as I want to. I can go even into abidance. And I know that the answer is wow to everything. All questions I already have answers, wow. And just stick with that. Just stick with it. Now, in real life terms, when obviously people are not going to just accept that right off the bat necessarily. But when we practice, we can practice like that, you see? And then this enables us to get used to abidance, used to more and more and more, and then wisdom will arise out of that. Wisdom, more and more wisdom will arise. And you'll be able to deal with the unbelievable cleverness of this, you know, of a consciousness that is reflecting here in this world. But also simply teach that teach this technique, you know, just get used to all answers being wow. So getting used to that, the more you get used to it, the better it will go for you. It's just all answers is just wow, is the answer to everything. The answer to every question is wow. Practice that, practice that, practice it, practice. Use the singularity, one answer for all questions, wow. And then an abidance arises seemingly out of nowhere. You know, you'll say, well, I know, okay. It came out of wow. It came out of wow. It was caused by wow. It's in the wow. The future is wow. And all parameters are covered by this. And you get more and more used to this. Then you'll just, you know, it'll, like, the clouds will burn away. It's so frustrating when you reach abidance, you accept abidance, and then you lose it, turn away from it. It's so frustrating. So you don't want to, like, do that a whole bunch of times, actually. It's demoralizing. You just think, oh my gosh, I had it, and I let it slip through my fingers. This is horrible. Keep turning the wheel of Dharma. So we really want to work on it in a wise way. And I said, look, I don't want it again unless I'm going to stay in it, because that just hurt me too bad to see it slip away like this, let it slip away like that. I said, man, I don't want to leave this. This is terrible. I was so feeling so secure. Abidance, you feel so secure. That nothing can harm you, nothing can touch you. So, and to lose that and go back into this feeling of vulnerability is just awful. So wow is the answer. Maybe you can start to see, like, okay, this is why this is being stressed, the singularity. Really, whatever legitimate non-dual teaching there is now, here, there, anywhere, you have to stress singularity as a practice. You just have to. You know, it's the sovereign technique, actually. Ramana, no matter what question arose, is who am I? Who am I is the question. So he used one question to eliminate all other questions. This is a technique he used. Who am I? Who am I? Whenever a question arose, he'd block it by saying, who am I? Now, so that's a singularity. What we do is we say, we have an answer, and we just say, you know, we could also say, wow is the question. Wow is, we could do it, you could say, the real question is wow. And the answer to wow is wow. It's all wow, you see that? It's a singularity technique. This is what enables us to stay in abidance. This is my strong conviction about this, which is why I'm practicing this way, because this is what I certainly want, and this is how I believe I'm going to get that. Sagadatta Maharaj was, I am. Everything is just I am. Any question, he just said, I am. So wow is the question. Wow. Yeah, and the answer to that is wow. Maybe people like dogs because they just bark, woof, woof, woof. They say, ah, oh, I wish I had that singularity. It's so simple, right? It reminds them deep down of something. It's like, yeah. But they're not sure what it is that it reminds them of. But once you realize, do the wow practice, you don't need a dog. You don't need a dog and all the hassles of a dog and pets in general. They use the dog to do the practice for them. They say, well, the dog's practicing for me. The dog's got singularity. That's good enough. Woof, 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 woof. So simple. Yeah, it's very smooth, very smooth. Just like our practice is very smooth here, right? It's very simple, isn't it? Very simple. There's not all this complex esoteric stuff, is it? It's just wow. More and more and more hearing that. And when you first glimpse how effective this is, you say, you will just be shocked, you know. And then you got to use the wow. You'll be so shocked. You say, oh my gosh, this actually does indeed work. This, my mind actually indeed is becoming more and more settled and simple and non-inquisitive about how did I unfixate. Fixation. We have to get off of that one ultimately entirely, right? Because we didn't have fixation in the first place. So the question, how did I unfixate anything at all? That's the question. We have to get off of that entirely. And of course, but that is the entire source of our arrogance, pride, to believe we're greater than God. And it's our entire belief that we can fixate the mind and stabilize hallucination, you know, and avoid our fear of the abyss. So it's very difficult for any of us to get off that question. We just keep coming back to it in one way or the other. It's like, yeah, it's great, enlightenment, but, you know. And a lot of teachers, you know, I am stressing the singularity in terms of looking at it. Is this is what really should be stressed as singularity. And maybe that's not very popular. You know, it hasn't been very popular here. But this is where it's at, plain and simple. You didn't hear Ramana straying too much from, you know, who am I, right? I mean, that was really very, very essential of what he was saying. He was stressing singularity. He says it's the quickest way, it's the fastest way, it's the surest way, it's the way that we need to use it in these times we're in. The singularity, okay, just that. Block all questions, what he was doing there. The yeah, but. And then some try to go along with that and try to give some comfort, you know, to all those questions, trying to explain this, try to explain that, and this and this, this and that. And, but really, you know, some of them, looking back, some of them did seem to teach, you know, in a very good way. They would say, well, some of them said, well, who's asking the question? Just look at who's asking the question. Now, I'm not exactly sure why they would say that exactly. Who is asking the question? It's a frustrating. It might be better, to, as we say, I like it better to say, wow. Just wow. So the question, the answer to your question is wow. And what you're really asking is wow. But a technique you could use a technique. Well, who's asking the question? No matter what question arises, you just say, who is asking the question? This is not meant to be another question. It's meant to block, it's meant to change your expectations to a singularity. So, you know, as far as how much do you indulge the questioning of anyone else is something I don't really know for sure at this point. So maybe they've been doing, you know, a perfect job, possible, right? Or maybe not. Maybe they just heard this technique and are saying it, and then but then indulging all the rest of the stuff. You know, that's also possible. but for our sakes, let us certainly focus on this singularity. We have a very good perspective now on why, you know, why is it so effective? Why is it so important? Why is it so necessary? Really, really, we do here. And we don't want to think too much about all that. We just say, why is it so important? Wow is why it's so important. Why is it so useful? Wow is why it's so useful. So it's the one answer to all questions. And the habit of questioning is what we need to wind down. We need to wind it down. And that's the toughest one of all, isn't it? It's the toughest one. Which in all questioning is really based on how did you unfixate fixation. They might say, wow, the ego might say, wow, stupendous. You're enlightened now. That is fabulous. How did you get enlightened, man? You gotta explain it. You know what? How did you finally figure out how to unfixate the mind? That is great. That's how everyone's trying to do that. You're gonna be so helpful to everybody. You're gonna be the savior of the world. This is great. You know, can you give a clear explanation of how you did it, or can you start helping us out how you did that? That's the ego, right? And boom, it dooms you right there. You're back in delusion. So wind down this whole questioning aspect of yourself. That's everyone has to do that. So this is what we really need to, the message that has to be given out is wind down this questioning aspect without being too brutal about it, I guess. I mean, it depends how far along you are. You know, if you're far along, maybe a teacher can just say, hey, you know, just wow, that's it. Like the stories of the Zen teachers. One day the Zen student has been practicing for 30 years or something, or 40 years, a long time. And he goes to the teacher and he says, teacher, you know, I've been here. It looks like you're getting ready to drop your body, and I still don't have it. You know, it's just, I've come so close, and yet I just think I just still, there's just something lacking, you know, I've still got some, there's some question I could, before you leave, can you just give me the answer? Maybe, you know, I'm just hoping I've been so loyal to you. Can you give me the answer? And the Zen teacher looks at me and just says, wow! And then drops the body or something, you know, like that. And then, you know, the student just, ah, suddenly, you know, Satori. So that makes a good story, doesn't it? But for us, it's really more prosaic than that. It's just the direct practicing like this. And I always disagreed with my dad because he loved to tell those stories. And of course, I was much more pragmatic. I said, no. You know, that makes a great story, but really, we have to do the tough work, and we need to practice this. Wow, not just, you know, expect the Zen patriarch before they drop the body to suddenly zap us with it, and then to be instant enlightenment. That's very sort of that spiritual romanticism, actually. And so I was very much against that, and my dad was very much for it. He loved spiritual romanticism, and I would just tell him, no, that's not it. And so he got really offended by that, you know, because, you know, spiritual romanticism draws an audience. And so I was like the guy in the audience saying, hey, yelling to the comedian or whatever. That's not that helpful. You know, you're not really helping us. That's really gets in the way of real true helpfulness. And, you know, and he's saying, like, throw this guy out of the audience. He's ruining my audience. He's putting everybody on a downer. So he really did kind of throw me out of the audience. Go to your room. Don't come out until you're ready to apologize. So I would just stay in there. I wouldn't eat, you know. I wasn't going to apologize. You know, after a day or two or something, I'd eventually come out and, sorry. But yeah, I was just like, really, you know, in other words, you know, you admit that you're wrong or else you're not going to be able to eat. And my mom would, like, bring me food or something. I'd stay in my room because he really... You know, he'd get ticked off about that. So I still am very much against spiritual romanticism for the most part. A little bit of it, you know, goes a long way, okay? But here, we're really into genuine success. And so we know we're not going to wait until the Zen patriarch's ready to drop their body and get the final word like that and expect that suddenly that'll rework all our expectations, sudden enlightenment like that. So, you know, that's, again, a very romantic notion. Just like we believe in romanticism in a lot of ways, and, you know, we realize, hey, it just doesn't work out like that, like the way we thought it would. What are we going to do, spend our whole lives holding our breath for it to work out that way? No. You got to work at it. Like relationships, you think it's going to be perfect, some storybook thing? No, it's not. Yeah, that's going to be, like, really tough work. You know, this happily ever after, you get married and live happily ever after. No, you live miserably ever after. And you have to work at it to avoid great misery. Right? Otherwise, you're going to have really, really great misery and probably get divorced. So you really have to work very much on it just to keep it in the realm of regular misery. Keep the wheel of Dharma turning, though, while you're doing that. So we really need to work on the wow, the singularity. Because this is the romantic, you know, wow of the Zen patriarch. It really is. It really is. And what those stories are telling us is this is really the answer. But they put it in such a romantic way to make kind of like, but you know, don't, you can rely on the patriarch to do enlightenment for you. You're like that. You don't really have to spend your life practicing the wow. You know, just be loyal to, you know, yeah, be loyal to what? To, right? That's the question, isn't it? Because is a true patriarch really going to play it that way? No. So the spiritual romanticism leads to, well, you might say, kind of dilettantish teachers, or the leaders that want to be followed. And they say, and people think, well, I can follow them and not really apply myself, and we can have fun and gallivant and all this, because they can just suddenly at the right moment, they're just going to, you know, give me that koan that's just going to Snap me out of my delusion, just like that. This is counter to reason and wisdom and deep understanding about expectations and how it all works. You can be snapped into temporary abidance. It's possible, but staying there is really the goal. Okay, so just getting a glimpse is just another day. And then you realize, oh my gosh, I don't know how to stay there. And those who don't know how to stay there sometimes set up shop about getting followers like that believe that they can be snapped out of it into abidance for a moment by who they're following, and they think that should be good enough. They say, that's my goal in life. I want to get a glimpse. So there's a lot of ego to that, right? To just get a glimpse. Because then the ego says, great, you just proved you can unfixate the mind, so now go back to work at it 10 times harder. You should be really, really great at it now because you saw it's possible. And then, of course, that's the last thing you want to have happen, right? That's a catastrophe. And so these people who are like that, they become gung-ho about, hey, I know there's a way to unfixate the mind, and I think I'm capable of help leading you and showing you how to do it. I'm a big shot now, and we'll all be able to evolve ultimately into this knowledge of how to unfixate the mind. We'll all be enlightened, and I'm helping you lead everyone to enlightenment and follow me, and stuff like that, right? That's what you want to avoid. So keep turning the wheel of Dharma. Keep turning the wheel of Dharma. Very important. And you know how you did it. Wow, is how you did it. And people will say, well, I'm not quite sure how wow did it. Can you explain more? Sure. Yeah, wow did it by wow. So did you apply wow? What did you apply wow to? I applied wow to wow. Well, what about before that? Before that was wow. I'm not quite getting it here. Is there some way, other way you could tell me? Sure. Wow. I could tell you in a wow way. How about something different? Wow. Sure. I can use, let's try wow as something different than wow. We're going around a circle, so are we going around a circle? Well, we're going around in wow, actually. Wow is what we're doing. But is this circular? It's wow is what it is. It's wow. Wow is wow. So the ego is happy to have you glimpse it, sort of. Abidance. Not, it's, would rather that you not, but it pretends it's happy. It pretends it's happy and says, great, you just are just proving that you're one of those special people that get to lead the new age of enlightenment. Congratulations, let's get to work on it now. Let's teach everybody how to undo the mind. Obviously, you've shown great potential in doing this. So let's build the potential up in everybody. So the ego will go like that. And if you follow that way, there goes your life. As you wander along aimlessly, again, believing you're on this terrible, dreadful death wheel of transmigration, that make-believe will continue. So keep the wheel of Dharma turning. It takes a little bit of effort, right? This wheel doesn't just keep turning on its own. It's not a fan. It's not an electrical fan. We have to give it a push. Keep giving it a push here. Keep giving it a push. And I'm having to go into the wow now because what all this information is very shocking to me because I realize this is very valid. What's being said, extremely clear and valid. And so, oh my gosh, this is kind of scary. You know, it's elation and trepidation mixed. Getting closer, right? Getting closer, getting ever closer. But in the meantime, keep the wheel of Dharma turning like that. Either you're having the right inquiry of breakthroughs, or you're practicing the singularity practice of wow. If you want to practice who am I, then align yourself with Ram Maharshi and practice who am I. Very simple. Or I am, align yourself with Sargadatta Maharaj and practice that. And if you are dedicated to this practicing, it will certainly work for you. There's no question about it. Whoever is dedicated to practicing singularity, it will work for them, no matter what. You can align with anything at all, as long as you're practicing singularity. Steady determination, effectively, it will be effective. You could align yourself with a tree and say, the tree is my guru, and the tree has told me to practice singularity, and then just practice it diligently and with steady determination, as we're advocating here, and it will be just as effective for you as it would for anyone else doing aligning with something else, you know, some other guru. It's the practice that works. Some use spaciousness as the guru to encourage practicing singularity. So like for Tibet, you might be sitting in a cave and looking out on this vast spaciousness with the mountains going on for endless in the distance, endlessly, this huge vastness. And they just say, wow. The vastness is wow. What I'm experiencing is wow. Everything is just wow. So as long as you're practicing singularity, it will certainly work for you, for any of us. On the other hand, if you refuse to practice singularity and you align yourself with even like Sri Sri Nandamaya Ma, it won't work. It won't work. You won't get to abidance. That's why she said, everyone practice, 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 practice. That's the Holy Grail. I said, no, Ma, you do it for us. She said, no, what I want you to do is practice, practice, practice. Make it a habit in your life. Become more and more and more dharmic. You must wear away, you know, your expectations. You must change your expectations. Nobody can force it upon you. Nobody can do that for you. You must do it. And she's right. There's some who spend a lot of time with her, and they're still, you know, on the wheel of transmigration and not. And others may have just spent no time with her, but got it through a dream or something, and they took it to heart and said, okay, you know, I know she's right about this, so I'm just going to have to do it. So keeping the wheel of Dharma turning here. Extraordinary, isn't it? It's really not so glamorous. You know, you just do it. Going back and forth is glamorous. Like, oh, I left it. Oh, but I went back to it. Oh, I left it. Oh, so you can throw a lot of drama in your life that way if you want to. But actually, it's so scary when you leave it. It's so scary. You know, I don't advise trying to do it. I mean, it's going to happen occasionally anyway, but certainly, don't try to do it on purpose. That's that kind of drama is more than anybody needs. So try to keep it smooth. Try to keep it going. It's like a big fidget spinner, isn't it? The original fidget spinner right here. I grew up with bicycles. Nobody took us anywhere. We had to ride our bikes everywhere, really. To school, to the store. I always ride my bike everywhere. So, you know, I love bikes because that was transportation. That was freedom. But my eyes are such that they're not so good. And my attention is not so good visually. It's too dangerous, you know, for me. I'm not gonna ride a bike around. It's really the way that cars drive now. You can tell that bikers are paranoid. I mean, the way but they ride right out in traffic. They're so aggressive. They bring some of it on themselves, but they're nervous. I mean, obviously, because their cars shooting out of everywhere. I'm amazed that more bicyclists don't get hit. It's really amazing that they don't. Well, they've convinced everyone it's always the car's fault. So cars are paranoid too here. There's so many bicyclists whizzing everywhere. It's very scary because for some reason, it seems like people seem to think that if a bicyclist gets hit, it has to be the car's fault. Not at all. That's not true at all. I almost hit one a while ago. A guy just completely ran this red light out of nowhere. He was going like 40 miles an hour. And I was turning left. The traffic at red light turned red for this traffic. And I had a green turn light to go. And he just thought that he could make it through before I turned. But he was coming out of the shadows. And I didn't hardly see him. So I saw him. I said, oh my gosh. And of course, I always drive slow just in case something like that happens. And this idiot just, you know, if I hadn't of been going slow and not in a hurry or anything, I could easily hit him. But he just said, I can't slow down. A red light doesn't mean I have to stop. I'm just going to blast through this intersection at 40 miles an hour. So idiots like that, you know, they are going to get hit. And of course, if they get harmed, they sue you. Sue the driver. Says, you know, you weren't looking out for us or something. Well, they're supposed to obey the traffic laws, which they rarely do. Rarely do, right? Pedestrians are a different story. They even have more of the law on their side, even if they run right out in the middle of the street. But bicyclists, they're going really fast. They're going as fast as cars are now. So they have to recognize that, you know, obey the traffic laws. A red light means they're supposed to stop and wait until the green light. But very few of them do that these days. It's amazing if they can get away with it, what they get away with. And so, anyway, it's stressful being around bicyclists here. There's so many of them. So it makes you drive extra careful. Extra careful. There's all these little kids riding bikes all over the place with their parents, and little kids, they're all over the place. And, you know, you think, oh my gosh, you know, I go really slow and give them a huge, because you might hit a crack or a rock or something and fall off the bike, or you just want to give them a lot of space, a lot of space. But this is really the bicycle mania is just roaring here. People, wow. And of course, Google's solution is to the traffic hell that they're causing, along with the other big firms, is just let them eat cake. They said, we'll turn the whole Bay Area into just one big bike path. You know, no more cars. Everyone rides a bike to work. Well, that's great if you can afford, you know, $5,000 rent for an apartment near a Google complex or something. Of course, if you work for Google, you can't afford it. But if you don't, you know, you get pushed far away from where you work. And, you know, ask somebody you ride to work, say, are you kidding? That's way too far. Way too far. And you get older, and you want to do a lot of errands after work. And so it's very unpractical. It's just really a let them eat cake, Marie Antoinette kind of comment. It says, no, let everybody ride bikes. It solves the traffic problem. Yeah. But the traffic problem, I'll tell you what solves the traffic problem. Is just pay all these workers like even more money so they can take vacations like constantly, which apparently half of the valley is able to take at least a month vacation, because half the valley's gone right now. The traffic is like it used to be in the dot-com bust and the recession here. It's thinned out amazingly. The gridlock's gone. Because what happened? Well, summer happened. And the kids got out of school, and apparently they have enough money to give their kids like a month or two vacation. They just take the whole summer off somehow, which is great. Which is great. But love it. Love it. And a lot of people come and they say, what in the world's going on? They haven't come back from vacation yet. It's true. It's true. So traffic is back to levels that, like, it seems like easy. Yeah, wow. Of course, actually, we're so used to being terrible, it seems great now. Like the good old days. But don't worry, after vacation's over and school comes back, it'll be worse than ever. Worse than ever. Because there's massive numbers of apartment complexes opening up now, all over the Bay Area. Who knows how many more people they're going to have in the Bay Area? Maybe millions, you know, there's so much apartment and commercial space opening up. Everywhere you see massive commercial buildings being built. Crazy, huge complexes. And it's already gridlocked. And so you're looking at making it exponentially worse, actually, very soon, within this year, next year. This next year is probably Armageddon for traffic. And my job is to drive through all this traffic, so it's really Armageddon for me. And so, you know, one of the reasons I'm pushing so hard is because of this. It's like job Armageddon is coming to me. And it's just going to be, you know, you have to be a saint to handle it. But it's too dangerous also. And that's all coming up. A friend of mine, acquaintance, he left. He says, I see the writing on the wall. It's going to become impossible where I live. And he's right. He's absolutely right. It's going to be just an absolute parking lot where he lives as far as trying to get to work. It might take him like 2.5 hours to get to work. Whereas if the traffic was light, it would take him 15 minutes. That's how bad it's getting. You know, it's kind of like a friend of mine went to Beijing recently, and he said, man, the traffic there was just absolutely insane. It was so terrible. It's just like gridlock everywhere. I said, well, you know, this is the new Beijing, actually. It will be. It will be the new Beijing here. It absolutely will. So, you know, my job is to drive through that all day. So you can see how the nooses, you know, are around my neck right now, actually. So that's why I'm keeping the Dharma wheel turning here, and how abidance to me is so crucial. This issue is so crucial. Because I want to be able to do something else, you know, other than what I'm doing now. Because the writing is on the wall that is just going to be hell. I better not strain my back as much as I did, though, today. I don't know how it'll go, but that was a lot of strain on the lower back. I may pay a price later on in life, you know? Or not. You know, in abidance, you don't have to pay a price, actually. You realize that. Why did Ramana get cancer, then? He didn't care. He had done what he came to do. Could he have cured it? Of course. But to him, he was so pure in his non-identification. He wanted everyone to see truly, truly, that it is possible to really have no identification really with the body at all here. And that what he had told us is absolutely true. And so getting that sepsis and cancer of the arm and whatever it was, he allowed it so people would realize, truly, wow, look at this. Maharaj same had cancer, some lung cancer, something. He says, it's not happening to me at all. Absolutely is not happening to me. But from a pragmatic standpoint, also, you could say that being well enough to really stick around and vitally witness in a lot of ways, that could also be useful. That could also be useful. Oftentimes, what is that? It's hitting something. I'm not sure what it's hitting right there. So the Dharma wheel is just suddenly hitting something. And now it's not. Okay, so. So you can play it either way there, okay? So you can get well. You can get well. And maybe that can be helpful also. Jesus tells us we can function here absolutely perfect. The body will function flawlessly as long as we want it to. A million years if we want it to, he says. Yeah, no problem. No time limit to it. He says most choose not to do that. Some choose to do that, actually. A few, he says, a few have had their bodies here for a long, long time. Now, I can understand that may not be the funnest thing around, right? But it's doable. So I needn't suffer, you know, from any back problem or anything like that. I needn't suffer at all, actually. This the knee problem I have is actually very helpful. It's kept me out of trouble. It's a blessing in disguise. So I just put up with it and say, okay, that's great. It's still keeping me out of trouble. Because these great breakthroughs that are happening cause so much ferment, you know, in my deep psyche that I feel like, oh, I want to do something. I want to really just, you know, just fly and dance and just give beauty to everyone and, you know, just wow. And then, you know, I could let me record a bunch of music and let me just do everything. I feel so expansive and creative. You know, it's very dangerous that way. So the knee kind of slowed me down, and otherwise I'd be dancing around, that is for sure. I'd be running backwards and sideways. I was doing that for a while, but I'd be doing that even more so to a great extent, probably doing modified parkour, actually, of all sorts of stuff, because it's just fun. It's fun. It's fun to be bouncing and jumping all over the place. And my psyche feels like that. I feel like jumping and leaping and bouncing and flying. I'm so exuberant, feel so, you know, so free of, you know, wow, my destiny is not misery, you know. Let's celebrate, that kind of feeling. So the knee has precluded that, which is great. Now, I can play golf, but it hurts it a bit. It was sore today. Hopefully it'll be better tomorrow. As we keep the Dharma, the wheel of Dharma turning here. So we've done a great job here. You see, and it's just showing you can do it for two plus hours here, right? And yeah. Very doable. So maybe one more spin like that. I don't know what I was hitting. Must have been hitting the brake or something. Yeah. All right. Very great. Very great. The advancements continue. We're really, really working on what is so crucial right now. Just wow is the answer. All answers. Wow is both the question and the answer. Let's put it that way. Both the question and the answer. Wow is both the question and the answer. Just get used to that and believe it. Really feel it and believe it and commit to this. And you will feel... there's a moth there. I don't want it to get hurt. Big one. It looks like it might have flown through the spokes also. I'll just keep it going real slow here so it doesn't hurt the moth. Beautiful big moth there. So maybe there may be times when you want to just keep it going, but not too fast. Wow is both the question and the answer. All questions and all answers. Wow is all questions and wow is all answers. Try that. Wow is all questions, and wow is all answers. A lot of spam on YouTube now. Somehow, there's some apps that must have figured out how to get around stuff. And, you know, just what I get is you know, this stuff. Hey, I really love your videos. Great job. By the way, you know, I know this is marked as spam. It's got a link, but click here and you can use my music. Or click here, I need a donation for something. Or click here. That's what we're getting now on YouTube. So, you know, you just have to, like, you know, just put up with that. Faster now, the moth is not around so much right now. Just keep your practicing going, no matter what you're doing. Oh, there's above my head now. no matter what you're doing, keep it going. Keep it there. Oh, it's flying by my ear, and there it goes. So, yeah. All right, we'll turn the lights off so the moth will not be attracted to these spokes. And that's very great. The new way is wow. Both the question is, all questions are wow, all answers are wow. All questions are wow, all answers are wow. All questions are wow, all answers are wow.